all members' opening statements be made part of the hearing record if they're submitted to the clerk by 5 p.m. today or the close of business, whichever comes first. And hearing no objection, that is so ordered. Without objection, the chair may also declare a recess subject to the call of the chair. As described in the notice, statements, documents, or motions must be submitted to the electronic repository for this hearing, and the email address for that is hnrcdocs@mail.house.gov. Additionally, please note, as with in-person meetings, members are responsible for their own microphones. As with our in-person meetings, members can be muted by staff, but only to avoid inadvertent background noise. Finally, members or witnesses experiencing technical problems should inform committee staff immediately so that we can help you out. I'll begin by recognizing myself for an opening statement. This hearing is being held virtually today because we find ourselves still battling a global pandemic. Ironically, that pandemic stems from zoonotic disease and the trade in wildlife. Here at the Natural Resources Committee, we've held numerous hearings and worked on several bills to address the wildlife trade and trafficking problem. We know that wildlife trafficking is a multi-billion dollar transnational criminal enterprise, and it's the fourth most profitable type of transnational crime. Today's the first time we will be looking at how complicit online social media platforms like Facebook enable these harmful illicit practices. In this subcommittee, we often talk about how conservation of species and their habitat is critical for biodiversity as well as the communities that depend on these ecosystems. But across the globe, there are few remaining places where humans have not impacted wildlife. There are countless human-related threats to species, including habitat destruction, industrial and commercial activities, pollution, disease, and climate change impacts. Illegal poaching, transit, trade, and the sale of animals by individual criminals is yet another serious threat to biodiversity. It's especially concerning that these individuals and their crimes are no longer confined to brick-and-mortar markets or the dark web. These illegal transactions are now almost exclusively taking place out in the open on virtual marketplaces, most notably through social media platforms like Facebook. Social media companies and the servers predominantly responsible for hosting this illegal activity are based here in this country, in the United States. As criminals around the globe increase their use of these platforms to attract buyers and facilitate their operations, we must hold these companies accountable. The largely unregulated virtual marketplace poses extraordinary challenges for combating illegal actions online. Effective enforcement actions will require global collaboration of private interests. The illegal trade of wildlife and wildlife products contributes to a shockingly lucrative crime economy, estimated to be worth about $23 billion per year over the past decade. This kind of revenue and the trafficking systems it creates undermines security in the United States and threatens stability of the entire global geopolitical structure. It has destabilized local communities and national governments by exacerbating corruption and reducing ecotourism revenue. In addition, several organized crime syndicates, insurgent groups, foreign military units, and even terrorist groups have been linked to wildlife trafficking. Legal loopholes, jurisdictional gaps, and online anonymity allow them to operate with impunity. They use social media to create content, groups, pages, or forums to market their illegal goods and easily connect to consumers drawn to their content by algorithms, the same algorithms that are at the heart of Facebook's incredibly lucrative business model. A 2016 report by Traffic, a wildlife trade monitoring network, noted that Facebook Inc. is a primary facilitator of wildlife and natural resource trafficking. Facebook Inc. operates Facebook, Instagram, Messenger, WhatsApp, and Novi. Upwards of 70% of illegal cheetah trade occurs on Instagram alone. Criminals capitalize on loopholes like Facebook groups and pages that allow a layer of protection and control for group administrators. As you can imagine, we have lots of questions for Facebook, but they declined our invitation to testify today. In 2018, Chair Grijalva and I wrote a letter to the SEC urging them to investigate a complaint regarding Facebook's failure to disclose to its shareholders the illegal wildlife trafficking occurring on its site. In a subsequent 2018 letter to Facebook CEO Mark Zuckerberg, Chair Grijalva reiterated concerns that sites owned by Facebook are primary enablers of wildlife trafficking crimes. Does Facebook care? Well, despite joining the Global Coalition to End Wildlife Trafficking Online, an agreement between technology, e-commerce, and social media companies, wildlife and natural resource trafficking has actually increased on their platform. Regardless of Facebook's PR claims that their community agreements prohibit wildlife trafficking on its platform, the benchmarks show failure continuing at every turn. For example, the sale of ivory products on Facebook has increased nearly 50% since 2016. Since 2018, wildlife trade on Facebook has increased in every country within Southeast Asia, a major hub of this illegal activity. Similarly, for many endangered species, that trafficking has increased on Facebook since 2018. The problems don't stop there. A recent BBC investigation revealed that land grabbers are openly selling illegally taken parcels in the Amazon, including public and indigenous lands, on Facebook Marketplace. When confronted about the matter, Facebook issued a statement asserting that they'll not take independent action to halt the trade of Amazon rainforest on its platform. Even more alarming, Facebook has allowed the sale of wildlife linked to COVID-19 and other zoonotic diseases, highlighting additional public health consequences of their failure to act. The internet has made a previously difficult task increasingly more complex, but it's our job here in Congress to tackle these challenges, and I hope this hearing will be an important step in that direction. I look forward to the testimony today and hope that my Republican colleagues will work with me to tackle these issues. And I'll now recognize Ranking Member Benz for his opening statement.
Thank you, Mr. Chair. Today's hearing will focus on illegal wildlife trafficking, particularly online. No country is untouched by these crimes, and the primary beneficiaries are, of course, criminals. There's no simple solution to this problem. As we will no doubt hear from the witnesses, combating illegal wildlife trafficking requires the cooperation of multiple federal departments, such as Interior, State, Justice, and Treasury, as well as international partners. Add access to the internet, and the problem becomes infinitely more complicated. While I am eager to learn how we can help curb illegal wildlife trafficking online, I am concerned that we are heading into territory outside the jurisdiction of this committee. There's nothing wrong with educating ourselves about the issue, but at the end of the day, we need to respect other committees' jurisdictions. To that effect, I hope any proposed legislation relevant to this subcommittee goes through the regular order so we can have a meaningful dialogue and debate about the merits of the proposals we may hear. However, what is clearly within our jurisdiction is the U.S. Fish and Wildlife Service and their work enforcing the Lacey Act. I look forward to hearing from Mr. Girton on how the service intends to use the millions we in Congress have provided to address wildlife trafficking under the American Rescue Plan Act. I also look forward to hearing from our witness, Ms. Catherine Semser, from the Property and Environment Research Center in Bozeman, Montana. She too agrees that online wildlife trafficking is a problem, but her work in reducing poaching of these species will be helpful to the committee, I am sure, as well. As we begin today's proceeding, I would be remiss if I didn't take this opportunity to highlight another very real issue. Our Western states are facing continually worsening drought conditions, and this committee should begin a serious focus on this matter. My California Republican colleagues think similarly with a letter, reflected in a letter we received today. Mr. Chairman, in my district, and I'm guessing in most of California and actually other Western states, this is most dire. The Klamath Irrigation Project and others in that basin are facing the most serious water shortage since 2001. In fact, all 17 Western states are experiencing some level of drought, with 13 of them experiencing extreme or exceptional drought conditions. Last week, April 20th of 2021, 75 million people living in the Western United States were affected adversely by drought. By ignoring this issue, we are putting the West at risk of the severe drought leading ultimately to, of course, catastrophic wildfire and community damage. We currently have 5 active large fires, and sadly, I am sure it's only going to get worse. I sincerely hope we can hold a hearing and act in a bipartisan fashion on these pressing issues very soon. I believe every reclamation authority needs to be on the table. This includes reauthorization of the WIN Act, drought declarations, and state flexibilities on groundwater use, conservation, and operational regulatory improvements. While we cannot make it rain, we need to do everything we can to help our constituents. Time is passing, and we need to address this issue. I yield back, Mr. Chair, my time.
Thank you, Representative Benz. For our first panel today, we will hear from the administration. Mr. Stephen Guertin is the Deputy Director for Policy at U.S. Fish and Wildlife Service. And after his testimony and a round of questions, we will have a second panel with invited witnesses. Let me take a moment to just remind all of our witnesses that under our committee rules, we ask them to limit their oral testimony to 5 minutes, but their entire statement will appear in the record. Again, a reminder to everyone to mute yourselves if you are not speaking. But for our witnesses, when you begin, the timer will begin, and it'll turn orange when you have 1 minute left, so watch for that. I recommend that members and witnesses remotely lock the timer on their screen after your testimony is complete. Please remember to mute yourself again to avoid inadvertent background noise like what we are hearing right now from one of our participants. I will now recognize Mr. Guertin to testify. Welcome, sir.
Thank you, Mr. Chairman, Ranking Member Benz, and members of the subcommittee. I'm Steve Guertin, Deputy Director for the U.S. Fish and Wildlife Service, and appreciate the opportunity to testify before you today. Wildlife trafficking was once predominantly a crime of opportunity committed by individuals or small groups. Today, it is a multi-billion dollar illegal trade largely carried out by international criminal organizations that are capable of moving large commercial volumes of illegal wildlife. And much like the trade in other goods, a significant portion of the wildlife trade has moved online. The international illegal trade in wildlife online is widespread, being conducted publicly and with little regulation. Online marketplaces and social media sites are used to facilitate the illegal wildlife trade by providing a platform to advertise illegal wildlife, second, for sellers and buyers to communicate with a global network of criminals, and third, to facilitate payments and movement of money. A simple search of social media sites illustrates the significant volume of wildlife being openly offered for sale. Wildlife and products including live songbirds, tiger parts, live cheetahs, elephant ivory, rhino horns, pangolin scales, shark fins, live turtles, and much more can be found for sale online, which is a simple search. We are also seeing a significant increase in the use of online platforms to market fraudulent Native American arts and handicrafts. Online platforms are being used to market these illegal products in the U.S. and across the globe, threatening species conservation as well as the livelihoods and culture of Native American artists. The devastating impacts of the COVID-19 pandemic have also made it clear that more needs to be done to combat the illegal trade in wildlife, as it can provide a vector for the spillover of zoonotic disease to humans. Online platforms facilitate global connections and enable wildlife traffickers to market products that risk the spread of zoonotic diseases to the entire world, putting us all at risk of future pandemics. Based on our ongoing investigations over the past decade, we know that the illegal wildlife trade spans the globe. The same trade routes can be found in the illegal wildlife trade online. Online platforms have made it much easier and faster for criminals trading in illegal wildlife products to connect across the globe. And criminals at all levels can be found buying, selling, and connecting with each other using online platforms. One of our challenges in dealing and addressing the illegal wildlife trade online is that not all wildlife is illegal to sell or own, and it's difficult for law enforcement to determine the legality of an item simply by looking at a picture online. However, the most trafficked species are protected by CITES and have little to no legal market for sale of those species or related products. For example, elephant ivory, rhino horn, pangolin, and tiger parts have few or no legal markets. Another challenge is that simply shutting down an online marketplace or post or removing an account will not stop the problem. Many criminals will simply create a new post or a new profile, creating a never-ending cycle for law enforcement to catch these criminals. The service is well positioned to combat the illegal wildlife trade with law enforcement efforts to to break up transnational criminal organizations, the interdiction and inspection of wildlife shipments at U.S. ports of entry, implementation and capacity building for sightings, and programs aimed at reducing demand for wildlife products. Recent investigations led by our Office of Law Enforcement have shown extensive and ongoing use of social media, online marketplaces, and online payment platforms to facilitate and promote the illegal wildlife trade. For example, just last month, a Texas man was sentenced to 20 months in prison for his role in an international smuggling scheme involving more than $8 million of protected wildlife. Facebook was used to connect suppliers of rare and protected wildlife in Mexico to customers in the U.S. and worldwide. Effective law enforcement in this arena will not only require collaborative interagency and international efforts, but also strong partnerships with the private sector. One successful example is our partnership with eBay. By working together, eBay has significantly reduced the volume of suspected illegal wildlife products on their platform. The service looks forward to building on this success and partnering with other companies to reduce the illegal wildlife trade online. Thank you for the opportunity to testify today, and be pleased to answer any questions that you may have.
Thank you very much, Mr. Gurdon. I'll now begin by recognizing myself for 5 minutes. Mr. Gurdon, as you heard in my opening remarks, we invited Facebook to testify today, and we're disappointed that they declined our invitation. I'm curious, you are with the agency that is responsible for enforcing wildlife laws. We know what a struggle it's been to act on the abundance of evidence that these illegal activities are taking place on the internet. Has Facebook been helpful to the Fish and Wildlife Service?
Thank you for your question, Mr. Chairman. We've had some conversations through the years with Facebook about the presence of illegal wildlife and wildlife products on their platform. We welcome the opportunity to work with them. We have a recent case we just contacted last week with a letter involving a very large group involved in wildlife trafficking of protected species from Brazil into the U.S. Facebook has acknowledged receipt of the letter. We're awaiting further action from the company. Most of our interactions where we deal with them and we need specific information, we have to go through a legal process, Mr. Chairman, and they usually want a subpoena for us to be able to gain access to any of their records or background materials.
But let me make sure I understand that. You're saying that they don't voluntarily cooperate with you, you have to subpoena them?
We normally would only get access to the records through a legal process. Yes, Mr. Chairman.
And does the Fish and Wildlife Service have administrative subpoena authority to obtain basic information from a company like Facebook?
Mr. Chairman, we do not currently have that type of authority for issuing administrative subpoenas. We would have to go to a U.S. attorney, and he would approach or she would approach the sitting grand jury and get us that subpoena to do so.
Have you heard from Facebook recently?
The last communication we had with them was acknowledgement of they've received our communication about this trafficking issue down in Brazil, sir. We have not heard back from them since then.
All right. How does the lack of that administrative subpoena authority limit your ability to do your job when it comes to illegal wildlife trafficking online?
It's a very dynamic and fast-moving environment, Mr. Chairman. Certainly, if we had that administrative subpoena authority, we would save several hours or days in our ability to look into some of these emerging cases as we try to build evidence against some of these criminal organizations. So that authority would just be much more empowering to us to move more quickly in this very fast-moving global wildlife trafficking arena.
Mr. Gurdon, are there examples of other online companies that have been helpful and cooperative in your work to stop this illicit activity?
Yes, Mr. Chairman, we have a very productive and proactive partnership with the eBay organization. They've approached us, and we're working very collaboratively with them on information sharing. They've done a lot of proactive work on their platform using their own analytics and technologies to take down a lot of these posts, disrupt a lot of the trafficking that's going on there. And we're not seeing as much presence on their platform as we did historically. And this kind of proactive approach has been very beneficial to our mission of conserving wildlife worldwide.
What else would you like to see online companies like Facebook do to be better partners in combating illegal wildlife trafficking?
If they would cooperate more proactively with us in our investigations when we request so through our law enforcement channels without having to go through a formal legal proceeding, Mr. Chairman, if they get wind of or can identify illegal trade going on, contacting us to let us know about it so we can launch an investigation. A lot of them will take down accounts when they find it. It would be very helpful if they archive that information behind those accounts. That would be very helpful for us to start connecting the dots and putting together a case to do a further investigation. Very helpful would be offering any type of educational information to their customers about the laws and treaties that regulate wildlife trade and any type of restrictions or flags they could put in place as well. A lot of this can be done through their analytics and their algorithms and their management of the vast amount of data they maintain on these sites.
All right. Thank you very much. And again, Facebook really should have agreed to be part of this hearing. We're disappointed that they didn't show up. Also disappointed that they put out empty PR points about how their policies prohibit this type of activity that everyone knows is thriving on their platform. It is a little bit like Claude Rains in Casablanca decrying the gambling that is all around him. So with that, I will go to Ranking Member Benz and recognize him for 5 minutes.
Thank you, Mr. Chair. Mr. Girton, your testimony, I think, highlights that just shutting down the online post is not necessarily a perfect solution. And before I leave that, has your agency done an analysis of exactly what you would ask Facebook to do? And I think you kind of bumped into it as you were talking about what other folks are doing, eBay, for example. So if you were in charge, what would you tell them to do again?
So our request for our private sector partners is that we want to work with them proactively. We want to work with them behind the scenes. We don't want to have to always go through a formal law enforcement request or a subpoena. We would like to share information with them. They have the ability to take down these sites, certainly. They have the ability to block usage. It would be very helpful for us to work with justice and our state counterparts to pursue action against them if we could have that archival information so we can amass the intelligence we need to connect these networks behind the scenes. We're not so much interested in a consumer here in the U.S. buying a product as we are the group behind those larger sales there, which is all closely intertwined with the larger illegal global trade in wildlife. So our approach is, a proactive approach would be much more effective and would be much more supportive of the goal of eradicating the trade in illegal wildlife.
It has been suggested that the department perhaps should address poaching as opposed to the advertisement and the bringing the buyer and seller together. Do you agree that addressing the issue as close to the source of these animals as possible is a perhaps more lasting solution?
Sir, we believe it's a combined arms approach where we want to go after the online presence and trafficking, but we're also very active in going after the sourcing of this illegal wildlife. We do a lot of work overseas with AID, with the State Department, through our International Affairs Program. We do a lot of monitoring capacity, training of law enforcement overseas. We do a lot of work to get after the source and try and cut it off before this product becomes available on the online traffic as well. So part of a multidimensional strategy to try to contain it at the source, try to manage it and eradicate it in transit, and then certainly to stop it from coming into the country here.
And perhaps you can share with us your judgment of the volume of this problem. I know it certainly existed before the internet. We all know that. Has the problem grown twice as bad? How do you measure how much worse or not that it currently is?
That's a great question, Congressman. We've been tracking this for about a decade now. we're seeing the scale approaching some $20 billion a year in illegal wildlife trafficking. We're also seeing the devastating impact it's taking on these charismatic species and lesser species throughout the globe. African elephants have seen a decrease of over 100,000 over the last few years, only about 400,000 left in the wild. They can't sustain 10 to 20,000 animals being taken from these herds each year through illegal poaching. Rhinoceros, only maybe 20, 25,000 left in the wild, 12, 1,500 a year being poached. These animals cannot sustain that kind of pressure at a population scale. Shark finning, millions of them every year being taken, finned and left to bleed out in the ocean there. Pangolin, a lot of pressure on those populations in Asia and Africa, devastating consequences to these wildlife populations. And so when you add it up, it's tens of billions of dollars a year, which is increasing. And we believe the use of these social media platforms and financial platforms and others has made it very simple for these organized criminal syndicates to take this business plan to theirs at scale and industrialize it and really move forward with a, to them, very low risk and high reward business model.
And in the short time I have left, is there anything that you, that the service is asking for that we Congress, we in Congress do to address this trafficking issue?
Thank you for that question, Congressman. I think holding this hearing is a wonderful gesture to raise awareness about this global issue that we're all dealing with, and will be very helpful to get a lot of attention here. Specifically for us, for the service, we're very appreciative of the support we receive through the annual appropriations process, as well as the recent funding in the Rescue Act. We're actually hiring 24 new agents and 30 additional wildlife inspectors to augment our existing staff. That'll go a long way. Mentioned this tantalizing idea of potentially giving us that administrative subpoena authority would be a big help to mobilize a lot quicker. And we'd be glad to work with our committee staff and leadership to flesh some of those ideas out as well. And then just ongoing support for our mission and our partners and the state fish and game agencies and our international partners as well.
Thank you, Mr. Girton. I yield back.
Thank you very much. The chair now recognizes Representative Costa for 5 minutes. I think Mr. Costa has, he may not be with us. And so let me go to the next witness in order. One moment. Our next member, rather. And that, I believe, is Representative Dingell. Debbie, are you with us? We'll get this batting order straightened out here on the Democratic side. Congressman Lowenthal, were you ready to go?
Always.
Let's do it. 5 minutes, sir. Thank you.
Well, thank you, Mr. Chairman. Mr. Girton, my colleague, Don Young, and I have long championed the Fish and Wildlife Service's international affairs and related programs. This year, we're asking for the maximum amount of money in our appropriations, the $30 million. As you know, this program provides the Fish and Wildlife Service important tools for wildlife conservation and stopping some of the illegal wildlife trade. And while I understand that this program that we champion, the International Affairs and other programs like it, give Fish and Wildlife Service some tools to oversee the issue of illegal wildlife trading. But oftentimes, those that we're trying to deal with, the criminals and the technology has been pointed out that they use, like Facebook and others, can be really one step behind. So the question is, what is your current intelligence capacity to properly track, investigate, and enforce issues related to illegal wildlife tracking on the internet? Can you expand, my first part is, can you expand on how the capacity has scaled up with the increased role of the internet, have your own capacity to track these and to intelligence? Have you scaled that up in terms of the internet scaling up? And where are you in terms of that wildlife tracking and your capacity?
Thank you for your question. Thank you for your question, Congressman. Yes, with your help in the U.S. Congress, we've been scaling up to get in front of or try to get in front of this growing internet use and support for the wildlife trafficking enterprise out there. We established a specific wildlife intelligence unit about 5 years ago based on some appropriations we received from Congress in, I think it was fiscal year 16 or 17. We currently have about 10 staff fully assigned to that. With several million dollars funding them each year. They are specifically working within the collaborative framework here in the U.S. and with our international partners to monitor all live intelligence. We're tied in with Interpol, with State Department, AID sources, U.S. military, and all of the assets we can bring to bear to do a better job of tracking, monitoring, forecasting the direction that this wildlife trafficking is going to be going. So it's a pretty robust and vibrant little program for a relatively small agency like the Fish and Wildlife Service.
What are the tools then, besides, you mentioned that how you've been able to kind of scale up, but what other tools does Fish and Wildlife need to better enforce issues related to illegal wildlife tracking on the internet? What other tools should we be thinking about together?
So, Congressman, we've also established a digital evidence recovery and technical support unit that we have been working on for the last several years as well. We're taking a look at the paperwork behind these transactions, bank records, sales, logistics, cell phone data. A lot of that evidence is very helpful as we build cases against these criminal networks. We also can rely on our forensics lab, a one-of-a-kind facility out in Ashland, Oregon, where we can evaluate actual specimens taken and get to DNA evaluation of what those samples are. And all of this evidence can be very helpful for us as we prosecute cases against some of these organizations. That's a very powerful tool we have. We've also deployed about a dozen attachés around the globe the last couple of years, and we appreciate the support from the Congress to do that. This is giving us eyes and ears in strategic locations such as Mexico, Peru, Brazil, Kenya, South Africa, Vietnam, China, AFRICOM, et cetera, where we're now embedded in the State Department organization over there, have eyes and ears on the ground to do a lot of work with the international community, with our host countries and with our NGO partners as well, to develop raw intelligence and try and get in front of our efforts to disrupt and take down these criminal enterprises out there.
Well, I just have 20 seconds left. I just want to know if you can just give a one sentence response. How can we strengthen some of these existing programs, Congress, to increase your capacity, your intelligence capacity?
Thank you, Congressman. We're a small but mighty agency. Any help we can receive in future appropriations, we would assure you we'll invest them directly into boots-on-the-ground capacity, much as we've done with these recent supplemental appropriations. We're putting the investment on wildlife inspectors, on special agents, and personnel to help get in front of this.
Well, thank you. I'm going to end now because my time and yield back, but I would like to say again, we are asking Representative Young and myself the appropriations for the maximum amount that we can, that we've ever asked for before. Thank you.
Thank you, Congressman.
Thank you, Congressman Lowenthal. I know many of us will be joining you in that appropriations request. So let's go to the Dean of the House, Chairman Emeritus Young. You're recognized for 5 minutes.
Thank you, Mr. Chairman. Thanks for this hearing. I hope you can hear me.
Yes, sir.
Okay. And thank Mr. Lowenthal for his comments. We've been working on this issue for a long time. It is an issue that I really ran into in Zambia. We were sending money to Zambia, and I was going to talk to the witness in a moment, and they actually were condoning some very illegal activities, their fish and wildlife. And I think we ought to pursue that more. As we distribute this money, we make sure that they're not part of it. The money, the countries receive that money for illegal trafficking of animals, poaching, and bad management. You know, I hate to get involved in other countries, but we're financing some of this, we should be involved. Mr. Gerton, your testimony states it's difficult for law enforcement to determine the legality of a wildlife item by looking at it in the picture online. And I just want to clarify your statement is not meant to support the banning of legal wildlife hunting and fishing. This is very important to me because we can't get this mixed up. Is that correct?
Yes, Congressman. I apologize if I had a confusing statement. Of course, we support the legal movement of wildlife and fisheries resources. We're talking to this hearing about the illegal, the bad guys.
All right. Following that up, your statement is not meant to insinuate that your support banning legal wildlife sales, such as fish or taxidermy, on the internet.
No, sir. If it's legally taken and the permits are there, that is not part of this larger effort, sir.
All right. And I do appreciate this, Mr. Chairman, what we're trying to do, because this is probably one of the worst things that's ever happened to, frankly, our wildlife. The demand for it is there, and the illegal people are selling it. We have some cases where Fish and Wildlife, I want you to know I'm a little irritated yet, Mr. Chairman, with Fish and Wildlife and former secretary. I got 41 polar bears in freezers in Canada. I'm trying to get them back. They're legal. And I keep saying that. Let's make sure the legal people recognize it as legal and not ignore, you know, on Facebook doing what they're doing. I agree with my ranking member. I don't think we have a jurisdiction, but we ought to bring that to the attention. There's going to be some regulations in the internet business. And what Facebook is doing is wrong. And we ought to be able to have some say in how we stop it. Because, you know, it's big money. When there's big money and the demand is there. We're going to lose a lot of our wildlife. And I again compliment you, Mr. Chairman. I'm tired of looking at you. I saw you this morning. And I'm just teasing. Anyway, Mr. Witness, thank you for your work. Keep up the good work. We have a lot of activity up here. And we'll be supporting you, Ms. Lothal, and I will be working to try to get you the money. But I want to make sure it's spent right now. And report to us. Have somebody report to us what's going on. What are the effects? What you think we should be doing? With that, Mr. Chairman, I yield back.
Thank you, Mr. Young. And when I saw you online this morning from your home, your Christmas tree was still up. So yeah. I want you to know that it is April 27th. Christmas ended several months ago, but maybe it's Christmas every day in the Young household. I don't know.
Mr. Chairman, I'm a conservationist. I keep the tree year-round, have it up. That way they have to cut out another tree.
All right. We're going to go to Congressman Ed Case. You're recognized for 5 minutes.
Thank you. Thank you, Mr. Chair, Mr. Gerton. First of all, I want to say that I had an opportunity to spend personal time with your agents here in Honolulu at the U.S. Post Office Central Processing Facility, where they also work very closely with the Fish and Wildlife Service on illegal trade, this being a port of entry here. And I just want to commend your folks here for the job they're doing under pretty difficult circumstances. That leads me into my second point, and that is that for the most part, we talk on these hearings about terrestrial illegal trafficking. And of course, I'm worrying about the Pacific Ocean here, where we have major illegal trafficking in marine resources, precious fishes, for the aquarium trade, which is in too many cases an illegal trade, as well as illegal trafficking in precious corals that are devastating coral reefs overseas because the demand is so high for them in our country. And so I saw your folks in action and all of that, and I'm certainly one of those that wants your resources to be significantly increased. Let me ask you a question here. Just listening to the testimony and trying to sort it through, it seems to me that there's three problems here. The first problem is the actual illegal trafficking in itself. And of course, we have international treaties as well as national laws along those lines. And the problem there is to enforce them. And your resources are insufficient to enforce that. I think we would all agree. The second issue is the actual advertising for the illegal activity. And the third is the platform utilized for the advertising. Of course, we're focused here on the platform because the platform is not regulating the illegal content. But do you, I don't know the basic question to this, excuse me, answer to this question, but is it illegal to advertise illegal trafficking? And I'm not, even if you're not actually the person doing the trafficking, is that an illegal act in and of itself that needs attention?
So I believe, Congressman, you're getting to some of the conversations we have about the Communications Decency Act, Section 230, somewhat shields these media and other online platforms from some legal liability. That would be more of a question to take up with the Justice Department than our agency here. We tend to focus on the individual users of online platforms or the rings promoting the big trafficking that's going on here. We'd be glad to help facilitate some follow-on briefings for committee staff, yourself, and leadership on the Hill about that issue. But not really one our mission is going to be aligned with, sir.
Okay. Well, I think it's an area that is in all of our interest to answer, because you're exactly right. That's what Facebook is sitting here dealing with, is Section 230. And if it is illegal to advertise, it's potentially the case that Facebook is saying, well, Section 230 provides us immunity against somebody who is illegal advertising on our platforms. That seems to me to be the issue right there. That's a 230 issue, and that's broader than just illegal trafficking in wildlife. But it has to be illegal to advertise it to start with for us to get into that area. So I think we've got a follow-up there. Let me shift gears a little bit with you ask you, Department of the Interior is the co-chair of the Presidential Task Force on Wildlife Trafficking, 16 other agencies. Can you just, is the task force engaged in this particular issue on a macro basis, so coordination across federal agencies?
Yes, Congressman, thank you for the question. This is an all-hands-on-deck effort for the administration. We work very closely as part of the federal family with not just the U.S. Fish and Wildlife Service, but defense, with Homeland Security, Customs Border Patrol, with the AID, the State Department, and all of Treasury Department is involved as well. It's coordinated through a larger mechanism. We feed into that process. We can bring a lot of expertise and capacity on the specifics of the wildlife trade. There are other areas who can work on the money laundering, the financial issues, diplomatic issues as well, but there's federal family.
Thank you. Just because my time is up, perhaps you could answer this in your written submissions, but has the task force actually coordinated a response on the question, which is the subject of this hearing, which is what, if anything, can be done about Facebook and other agencies' reluctance to really dig in full steam ahead on getting illegal advertising, if it is illegal, but certainly advertising of illegal trafficking off their sites. But my time is up, so that's a follow-up to you.
Yes, sir.
Thank you.
Thank you, Mr. Gerton and Mr. Case. The chair now recognizes Mr. Whitman for 5 minutes.
Well, thank you, Mr. Chairman. Deputy Director Gerton, thanks so much for joining us today. I wanted to focus on the work that the U.S. Fish and Wildlife Service does in investigating wildlife crimes. I know that you do much of that, and I just want to know if you're seeing other sorts of criminal activity taking place along the same trade routes that you see these wildlife crimes taking place. And if so, can you give us an idea about what are those potential crimes that you're seeing that are happening in conjunction with wildlife crimes? And are there any particular transnational organizations that you see that are common to the wildlife crimes area that also transact in other criminal activities across national borders?
Sure. Thank you for your question, Congressman. We're very well aware that many of the criminal organizations who traffic in wildlife also traffic in other illegal goods and items, such as weapons and drugs. We're also able to tie it in with a lot of other illegal activity, money laundering, mail fraud, wire fraud, narcotics offenses, distribution, et cetera. Come back to our point that this is a very low-risk, high-profit line of business for these organizations, and so they'll take advantage of it. Our investigations and intelligence research has shown that there are common bad actors who are involved in both wildlife trafficking and terror financing, for example. And we're confident to say that some of these same facilitators are moving products and money in both sectors. Some of this infrastructure that is moving wildlife products to market is also moving other goods to these groups as well. And so it's a very interrelated relationship out there, and wildlife can be one business line for many of these organizations, intertwined with many others.
Thanks. Thank you. I wanted to expand on that a little bit. As you spoke about, it's not just the illegal activities that cross national lines and cross organizations, but it's also the efforts that are necessary to combat these wildlife crimes and these illegal organizations. Those are essentially global operations, so they require multi-agency coordination, multinational coordination. Can you give us an idea about what challenges you face in trying to get agencies from other nations to cooperate? And you spoke a little bit earlier about what you do in coordination with other federal agencies. Can you give us an idea about how those coordination efforts, the multinational coordination efforts, could be improved, and what are the challenges that you face today look like?
Thank you, Congressman. Sure, the underlying framework for all of this work is the CITES that sets the kind of framework for us to work with the shared interest in managing and regulating the trade in threatened and endangered species. And so under that framework, we're one agency who can work with our counterparts overseas to provide technical assistance to their fish and wildlife organization. We can provide a lot of training and capacity to their law enforcement and rangers. We can work with our own appropriated funds as well as NGO partners on a lot of habitat and management practices on the ground. We can then do a lot of education and outreach as well. And then this coordination that goes on at a multinational level sets the framework for all of that work. There's also a lot of power in persuasion and setting a good example. And the U.S. is a leader in wildlife conservation and can hold up the examples of what we do here. And then certainly we can put a lot of capacity into these countries through USAID or the State Department. And we actually receive some pass-through money from AID for Central Africa for a lot of specific work that we do over there. So add all these tools together, we can be a very potent force for change out there working with our collaboration and all of our other partners.
Very good. Thank you. I'm going to ask a quick question. I know you've had a lot of experience in the international affairs of fish and wildlife. I will have a witness later that will testify to the impact, the positive impacts of properly managed hunting in Africa. Do you agree that hunting that is properly managed and wildlife harvest that's properly managed can help conserve species and generate revenue for impoverished communities?
Yes, Congressman. We've seen a lot of studies that the fees that go into hunters, guides, conservation permits can be reinvested back into a lot of very positive conservation benefit. And that's a model that's used throughout the world.
Very good. Thank you, Mr. Chairman. I yield back.
Thank you, Mr. Whitman. The chair now recognizes Mr. Soto for 5 minutes.
Thank you so much, Mr. Chairman. One would think a Central Florida flying squirrel transnational wildlife trafficking ring would be the stuff of movies or TV, but it in fact is occurring right in the Sunshine State. And one of those enterprises was just busted just a few months ago. 10,000 traps, 3,600 flying squirrels captured flying squirrels are federally listed as endangered and of course protected under Florida law as well due to their habitat loss. Over $230,000 in gross illegal proceeds. International retail value for the flying squirrel population was $1 million for what they had stolen. And they had tried to claim that these were bred in captivity, thereby laundering the otherwise wild Central Florida flying squirrels. We see this with alligators. We see this with turtles in Florida. And so my first question Deputy Director Gertin is, if you identify some of these ads advertising illegal sales of endangered animals, and you ask social media companies to take down those ads, do they usually take them down or no?
Congressman, normally most of the social media companies will not take them down on a voluntary basis. We can put a lot of pressure on them to do so. We can share information with them. Some of them require us to come at them with a legal authority, like a subpoena or something like that. The model we're trying to move toward is more of a voluntary, cooperative nature to these agreements, a shared vision for wildlife conservation, and partnering with them on taking these proactive measures.
Sure. And Deputy Director Gertin, do you think the penalties are sufficient enough for the vendors, for the folks who are selling these illegal and endangered species? Do you have the tools you need to go after them individually to make it unprofitable to do so?
If we can make a very strong case and bring them to justice, Congressman, some of these folks are seeing a number of years of prison time as well as pretty significant fines. The crux of the matter for us is having the capacity to be able to prosecute these cases. And so when we combine our resources with our great colleagues on the state fish and game agencies here in the U.S., we can multiply that effort and really try to build some strong cases. And we rely on our analytics, our own intelligence gathering, our shoe leather work that takes place to build these cases. And certainly any additional resources coming our way would be replowed right back into that effort.
Thank you. And Chairman Huffman, I know there was some curiosity over the jurisdiction over this issue. Last time I checked, we have 7 members of the Energy and Commerce Committee, also on the Natural Resources Committee, including myself. So I know there's several of us who would be willing to help work with you on this issue, should it be a matter of jurisdiction. That won't stop justice from happening. My last question, Deputy Director Gertin, we had a tough winter with our manatees in Florida, still listed as vulnerable status under U.S. Fish and Wildlife Services. We had a marine mammal unusual mortality event with nearly 10% of the population loss. Can you give me an update on U.S. Fish and Wildlife Services efforts with regard to the manatee?
Sure. We have a great partnership with the state on manatee management. We also have a great partnership with the recreational boating and fishing community on wake management and things like that. We have a shared interest in protecting these iconic species and doing all we can proactively with slow-moving boats in key areas, keeping traffic off of key areas when needed, a lot of public awareness, a lot of personal responsibility, and think with that strength of that partnership with everyone down there in the great state of Florida, we can work together to make sure that there are populations of manatee in the wild.
Thank you. I appreciate it, Deputy Director Gertin. And we're going to be working with you to make sure you have the funding to do it. We've had a near 10% population loss 2 years in a row. So can I count on your continued commitment to vigilance towards protecting the manatee in Florida?
Absolutely, Congressman. And I hope the OMB are not listening because everyone's asking about money. And we'll take it, but our budget isn't coming up to the Hill for another couple of weeks.
Thanks. My time's expired.
All right. Thank you, Representative Soto. And your point is well taken about jurisdiction. Our committee and our subcommittee may not have the authority to regulate social media platforms, But I think we have an obligation to draw attention to the way these platforms are being used and the damage that it's causing to wildlife and the enabling of Lacey Act violations and other things. So that's what today is all about. With that, I'll recognize Congresswoman Gonzalez-Colon for 5 minutes. And I'm not, Jennifer, are you with us? She may have stepped away. Ranking Member Benz, did you have anyone else on your side that wanted to ask questions?
You know, not that I'm aware of, Mr. Chair, but they would have to speak up if they do.
Yeah, and I'm not aware of any on our side either. So unless someone speaks up in the next 5 seconds, we will thank Mr. Gerton for your testimony. And at this point, we will transition to the second panel. Is that you, Jennifer?
I'm here. Yes, sir.
Okay, sorry. We lost you there momentarily, but you're recognized for 5 minutes, and then we'll go to our second panel.
Thank you. Thank you, Mr. Chair. I just want to establish, I remembered that expanding the federal funding opportunities has been highlighted by some of the testimony provided today. In addition to that, Mr. Gerding, your testimony highlights some of the work done by the Service International Affairs Program. And as you may be aware, this committee has given particular attention to allegations of human rights violations by partner organizations supported by international conservation grants awarded by the service. And these funds were intended to address wildlife conservation, an issue that of course is at the core of our hearing today, and therefore I think it's important we address this issue as well. And I remember I've been part of this committee since 2017, and in 2018 there was a report by the Department of Interior Office of the Inspector General that found instances where the International Affairs Program did not comply with federal regulations or Fish and Wildlife Services policies. And I understand the last administration worked to ensure all those failures were addressed. And I hope that Biden administration is continuing to address this issue as well. Do we have a commitment of the service to uphold the law and to ensure taxpayers' dollars are not used to fund human rights violations?
Yes, certainly. And we did a lot of work based on those allegations that surfaced to put in place much more stringent requirements, policies, and procedures. And we have no desire to be involved in any projects that would violate human rights whatsoever. And you have our commitment toward that end. Yes.
Thank you. And I just want to highlight how important I think it is to the trophy hunting and conservation efforts. And our goal should be promoting, as Chairman Young said, a legal practice and not illegal practice. So I want to thank you for your testimony. And with that, I yield back, Mr. Chairman.
Thank you very much. And thanks again, Mr. Gerton. We will now move to our second panel. I'll introduce them now. The first witness will be Ms. Gretchen Peters, Executive Director of the Center on Illicit Networks and Transnational Organized Crime, or CINTOC. Next, we'll hear from Mr. Alexander von Bismarck, the Executive Director of the Environmental Investigation Agency. Following Mr. von Bismarck will be Ms. Danielle Kessler, Acting Director in the United States for the International Fund for Animal Welfare, or IFAW. And our final witness will be Ms. Catherine Semser, a research fellow at Property and Environmental Research Center. So just a reminder, after the witnesses complete their testimony, please remember to mute yourself to avoid any inadvertent background noise. I will also allow the entire panel to finish their testimony before we bring it back to members for questions. The chair now recognizes Ms. Peters to testify.
Thank you for inviting me to testify about wildlife crime on the internet. My name is Gretchen Peters, and I'm executive director of the Alliance to Counter Crime Online. Our alliance brings together academics, cybersecurity experts, conservation groups, and citizen investigators working collaboratively to eradicate serious organized crime from surface web platforms, including wildlife crime. We have more than 40 members, about half of whom focus on the illegal online wildlife trade. This includes organizations like Wildlife Justice Commission and the World Parrot Trust, as well as academics who track primates, big cats, elephants, rhinos, marine creatures, reptiles, insects, and other invertebrates. We also have members like Lady Freethinker, that document online cruelty to animals, including the fake animal rescue videos that abound on YouTube and the horrific animal fight and torture groups that you can find in Facebook groups. Distinguished committee members, the world's largest markets for wildlife crime are right inside your smartphones. The biggest social media platforms, Facebook, Instagram, and WeChat, have become ground zero for wildlife crime syndicates to connect with buyers, to market their illegal goods, and move money. And the platforms profit off of this. This has happened for four reasons. One, surface web platforms provide much the same anonymity as the dark web and a far greater reach of customers, about 40% of the world's population. Number two, social media algorithms help criminals connect cost-free to customers, thereby amplifying crime. Number three, outdated U.S. laws provide immunity to the tech industry, and this is what Representative Case was speaking about earlier, even in cases when tech firms post illicit content. And number four, this immunity leaves tech firms with little incentive to develop technologies that block illicit activity. In the wildlife crime sector, this has increased the pressure on multiple species that were already endangered, including elephants, pangolins, cheetahs, various ape and parrot breeds. And additionally, it has spawned a truly ghastly global market for animal torture and fight videos. I'm submitting to the written record today our wildlife fact sheet, which provides a summary of the type of content that we track at ACCO. U.S. tech firms, in particular Facebook, often paint looming competition from China as a reason to let them get away with lax moderation policies and monopolistic behavior. Yet when it comes to addressing wildlife trafficking, Facebook is already being outdone by its Chinese competitors. 2 years ago, Facebook joined other tech companies, including China's Tencent, which owns WeChat, in the coalition to end wildlife trafficking online. The firms all pledged to remove 80% of wildlife crime from their platforms by 2020. That, of course, didn't happen. But Tencent's work with law enforcement did lead to the rescue of hundreds of live endangered animals, the removal of thousands of trafficking accounts, and the dismantling of an illicit wildlife trafficking network. And what did Facebook and Instagram do in this same time period? They merely launched a reporting mechanism for wildlife sales, which relied on users to report wildlife crime. Facebook is not the only American tech platform that hosts wildlife crime, but the world's largest social media platform has an extensive wildlife crime problem, and easy fixes the firm could be applying aren't being implemented. In a 2020 study, ACCO team members ran manual searches using 17 different word combinations in four different languages. And I'm talking about simple search terms like cheetah cubs for sale or buy elephant ivory. 57% of the pages we found had the terms for sale, buy, or sell in their title, as did about a quarter of the Facebook groups where wildlife appeared to be illegally traded. I want you to understand and that Facebook doesn't need artificial intelligence tool to find and eliminate this type of content. Simple if code could block search results and flag and remove groups and pages that combine sale terms with animal species terms. Facebook has chosen not to implement this simple fix. The question lawmakers should be asking the firm is why. In that same study, we found that Facebook algorithms recommended another 29% of pages and groups our researchers found. In other words, Facebook isn't just failing to remove wildlife crime, its algorithms actively accelerate it. Why haven't these algorithms been dialed back? I'm submitting a report two clicks away and request that it be included in the congressional record of these proceedings. Other changes like increasing moderation of private and secret groups, making it explicit to users that the firm will hand over apparent evidence of wildlife crime to animal and animal torture to law enforcement, the same way they must do with toxic content related to children. Plus, there are legal reforms Congress can enact. ACCO supports reforms to Section 230 of the Communications Decency Act to insert a duty of care for tech firms, which should lose their liability shield if they don't take reasonable steps to remove criminal activity, whether it's illegal drug sales, child sex abuse content, or wildlife. Distinguished committee members,
I'm going to come back. I will come back when it comes to questions and give you plenty of time to finish out your thoughts. You're making some really great points, and I want to give you that opportunity. But we have to keep moving, and I will now recognize Mr. Von Bismarck for 5 minutes.
Thank you.
Mr. Von Bismarck, are you with us? You might be muted. If Mr. Von Bismarck is unable to join us or had stepped away, we can go next to Ms. Kessler for 5 minutes, and we will come back to him if we can get that worked out. Ms. Kessler, can you go ahead and go now?
Thank you. Yeah.
Okay.
Chairman Huffman, Ranking Member Benz, and members of the subcommittee, on behalf of the International Fund for Animal Welfare, I thank you for the opportunity to provide testimony concerning wildlife cybercrime. Wildlife cybercrime has emerged alongside the whirlwind expansion of the internet and global declines in biodiversity as a challenge with serious and far-reaching implications. For more than 15 years, IFAW has investigated the ever-expanding and evolving world of wildlife cybercrime across continents, identifying tens of thousands of online advertisements and postings offering live, endangered, or threatened animals, as well as these species' parts and products. Building upon our work to combat poaching on the ground and educate the public about wildlife-friendly consumer choices, we have collaborated with enforcement officials, private companies, advocates, and educators to evaluate opportunities to rein in online wildlife trafficking. Much work has been done, but significant coordinated national and international action is needed to effectively disrupt wildlife cybercrime networks and in turn ensure that the survival and welfare of imperiled wild animals around the world. Since 2004, IFAW has conducted research that reveals the enormous scale of online wildlife trade. A 2008 report identified more than 7,000 advertisements offering endangered wildlife across 8 countries over a 6-week period, with the U.S. accounting for a substantial majority of those ads. Research and reports completed since that time revealed that online wildlife trafficking remains a significant and growing problem across continents, and a forthcoming 2020 analysis focused specifically on the U.S. makes clear that our nation remains a key player in this deadly marketplace. Notably, the data that we have gathered over the years, while worrisome on its own, provides only a partial view of online wildlife trafficking and its reach, because our findings reflected only posts that were accessible through public open source platforms. They do not account for trade facilitated by private social media exchanges, closed groups, encrypted platforms, and other more clandestine virtual channels, which are increasingly favored by wildlife traders for this very reason. In addition to profound conservation challenges, the burgeoning online wildlife trade has serious implications for the well-being of individual animals. In addition to wildlife parts and products, live animals regularly enter global trade via the internet, and their journey from the wild to the hands of a buyer can include extraordinary suffering. Many animals die from the brutal conditions of capture and transport, arriving at their destination starved or even crushed. Those that survive being ripped from their native habitats, restrained, denied food and water, exposed to novel pathogens, subjected to sometimes extreme temperatures, and shipped to distant destinations are passed off to buyers who are ill-equipped to meet even their most basic needs. Stopping online wildlife trafficking is essential to ensuring both the survival of species and the well-being of individual animals. Despite troubling findings regarding the impacts and extent of wildlife cybercrime, there is hope for species impacted by this trade. The parties to the Convention on International Trade in Endangered Species, or CITES, have adopted resolutions aiming to address the trade through international cooperation coupled with regional and national policy reform. A number of companies have established tougher penalties or enhanced enforcement mechanisms for online wildlife trafficking. Indeed, legislation referred to this very subcommittee in recent Congresses reflects Americans' increasing awareness of and desire to better protect wildlife from exploitative trade. In addition to researchers and policymakers, IFAW works with a coalition of technology companies around the world to identify opportunities for e-commerce and communication platforms to disrupt online wildlife trafficking. Since 2018, participating companies have removed or blocked more than 4 million imperiled species listings from their platforms. Of course, we do not assert that private action is a substitute for policy reform. Rather, we hope to build upon these successes with the support of the subcommittee and others in Congress who are working to protect wildlife in the U.S. and abroad. While I'm not here to ask the subcommittee to advance a specific piece of legislation today, I respectfully encourage you to consider the following recommendations and principles as you evaluate paths forward. Most importantly, we urge members of the subcommittee to ensure that as Congress considers revising or introducing legislation related to online commerce and communication, wildlife trafficking remains a priority and is clearly incorporated into any relevant legislative reform. Ensure that enforcement entities, including the U.S. Fish and Wildlife Service's Office of Law Enforcement, be provided with funding and resources sufficient to develop, implement, and expand tools and techniques for disrupting wildlife cybercrime. Invest in innovation and expand digital forensics capabilities within enforcement agencies. Avoid removing resources from traditional enforcement operations to fund digital operations. Both remain critically important to stopping wildlife crime. Establish and reinforce international and cross-boundary partnerships with enforcement entities, including Interpol. Incorporate wildlife trafficking considerations, including online trade, into policy reforms aimed at protecting public health and reducing pandemic risks. Incentivize reporting and protect whistleblowers who expose online wildlife trafficking. And finally, provide for science-driven and humane management of live wild animals intercepted by enforcement entities. Again, thank you for the opportunity to provide testimony on this important matter. I look forward to working with the subcommittee to advance wildlife cybercrime policy and protect imperiled species around the world.
Thank you very much, Ms. Kessler. I am told that there are some audio issues with Mr. Von Bismarck, and our IT folks are working with him to try to get those resolved. So we will hopefully come back to him to be our final witness. But right now, the chair will recognize Ms. Semser for 5 minutes.
Thank you, Mr. Chairman. Distinguished members of the House Natural Resources Committee, thank you for the opportunity to appear before you to provide testimony on this important issue. My name is Catherine Semser. I am a research fellow at the Property and Environment Research Center, a conservation research institute based in Bozeman, Montana. In addition to my position with PERC, I am also a research fellow at the African Wildlife Economy Institute at Stellenbosch University in Stellenbosch, South Africa, and a member of the Sustainable Use and Livelihoods Specialist Group of the International Union for Conservation of Nature. I also serve on the board of advisors of the Game Rangers Association of Africa, the continent's largest guild of protected area managers, game wardens, and anti-poaching professionals. The illegal wildlife trade is a significant threat to the United States and its allies. The industrial-scale killing of wildlife in which it is based contributes to systemic risks to the global economy created by ecological degradation. The trafficking of wildlife and wildlife products increases the risk of wildlife-borne diseases spilling over into our civilization, as well as enables transnational organized crime and other actors that threaten peace and prosperity across regions. Effectively engaging with the threat presented by illegal wildlife trade must involve addressing the corruption, limited legal authorities, and enforcement capabilities that enable it. At the same time, the United States must get ahead of the threat by increasing the opportunity costs for involvement in wildlife crime and decreasing the social license of wildlife criminals in communities at the beginning of the supply chain. Research shows this can be achieved by reducing the poverty, lack of economic opportunity, and disenfranchisement from conservation efforts felt by people living in and adjacent to conservation areas. Through thoughtful policies and interventions, the United States can empower law enforcement, decrease opportunities for criminal networks to recruit and function, prevent wildlife from being illegally killed or captured, and decrease the supply of illegal wildlife products available online and elsewhere. As the United States seeks to lead a green recovery and build back better in the aftermath of the COVID-19 pandemic, it should rally the private sector to address the chronic funding shortfalls faced by anti-poaching rangers and protected area managers in Africa. Nearly 60% of rangers in Africa surveyed feel they did not have enough equipment or adequate training to do their jobs effectively. This reality is rooted in persistent under-resourcing that has plagued African conservation areas. Available funding is estimated to cover only 10% to 20% of the management needs of conservation areas, including law enforcement. At the same time, the cost of doing the job effectively is relatively low. For example, fully funding the 282 state-administered conservation areas that support African lion populations is estimated to cost approximately $1.5 billion a year. However, these areas currently operate on a total annual budget of $381 million. The U.S. Fish and Wildlife Service should work with other agencies, including the International Development Finance Corporation, to leverage the growing pool of ESG investors and corporations concerned by the business risks of ecological degradation to address this challenge in ways that increase economic opportunity and the opportunity costs of involvement in wildlife crime. Policymakers must also engage with the threat honestly and avoid falling prey to politically convenient misinformation that equates poaching and hunting and gives a significant role the latter plays in efforts to combat wildlife crime. Finally, since listings of foreign species under the Endangered Species Act can result in restrictions on the importation of hunting trophies into the United States and decrease the willingness of American hunters to hunt overseas, the U.S. Fish and Wildlife Service should identify and make public the potential financial and operational impacts on wildlife law enforcement activities that these listings are likely to create. The United States should also work with the private sector to establish mechanisms and funding streams to address wildlife law enforcement shortfalls experienced by the public or private sectors that result from Endangered Species Act implementation, including import restrictions. Thank you again for the opportunity to testify. I'm happy to answer any questions you have.
Thank you very much, Ms. Semser. I see that we have Mr. Von Bismarck back. At least I can see him. I'm going to cross my fingers and hope that the audio has been resolved and we can also hear him, in which case I'll recognize him for 5 minutes.
Can you hear me, Mr. Chairman?
Perfect. You sound great.
Thank you, Mr. Chairman, ranking member, and members of the subcommittee. Thank you for inviting me to appear today. My name is Alexander Von Bismarck. I am executive director of the Environmental Investigation Agency. I've investigated global crime and natural resources for about 25 years, leading investigations around the world in criminal networks dealing in illegal wood, endangered species, and harmful chemicals. The nonprofit Environmental Investigation Agency has worked for more than 30 years to investigate and expose.
And we have just lost your audio, Mr. Von Bismarck. I don't know if you've hit anything inadvertently, but you cut out completely. Do you want to try again? It is just not there. I'm so sorry. So we will have your written testimony for the record, and unfortunately, we'll have to miss hearing it delivered. I will now begin the question part of our conversation by recognizing myself for 5 minutes. And I would like to start with Ms. Peters. Ms. Peters, you ran out of time a little bit, but I think you were making some very compelling points at the end of your testimony. Did you want to tell us anything you were unable to say in your opening?
Yes, thank you so much. One of my main points is that the issue that we're talking about today is not just limited to wildlife crime. There's all sorts of serious organized crime activity being hosted on the social media platforms that are U.S. firms. They're publicly owned firms, and we need to change the laws that allow those to host this illegal content. If it's illegal to do it in real life, it should be done online. And the wildlife space, I also want to say that we support the passage of H.R. 864, the Wildlife Conservation and Anti-Trafficking Act, that will be introduced again this year. And I'd like to thank the 9 members of this subcommittee who sponsored the bill: Don Young, Alma Amata Coleman, Jennifer Gonzalez Colon, Grace Nola Pinto, Debbie Dingell, Ed Case, Steve Cohen, Darren Soto, and Nadia Velasquez. This bill has really important provisions for fighting wildlife crime online, and it establishes a wildlife whistleblower program that provides financial incentives and crucial anonymity protections for relators of wildlife crime. But reforming the laws do take time. There are things the U.S. government could be doing right away to move on this while you reform the laws governing tech. There are complaints that have been filed to the Securities and Exchange Commission about the rampant amount of wildlife crime activity on Facebook, including wildlife crime. I'm part of one of those filings. The DOJ could also investigate Facebook to determine if the extent of organized crime on its platforms rises to the level of racketeering violations under RICO. And finally, the FTC could investigate the firm's deceptive practices around its willingness and capacity to restrict and remove illicit content, including wildlife crime, from its platforms. And many of these might, some of these things might be outside the remit of this committee, but many of the members of this subcommittee are on other subcommittees and committees that that have jurisdiction over these agencies.
So Ms. Peters,
I'm sure that together in the tech industry.
That is a great interest. And Ms. Peters, we know all this illicit activity is happening right out in the open. It's very overt. I want to ask you what social media platforms like Facebook are doing wrong. You talked about a basic artificial intelligence tool that you have developed to identify this, or even how a simple Boolean piece of code could do it. How is it that your technology works, and why aren't tech platforms doing something like that right now?
So I personally have developed AI tools, but several of our members have, including Dr. Tim Mackey out at the University of California, San Diego. That tool and others have been developed that are able to learn the patterns of online wildlife criminals and other criminals. These AI tools have also been used to identify drug dealers, COVID fraudsters. I think it is a question that needs to be asked to the tech industry, why they're not implementing these tools more comprehensively. But I think the bigger one of the bigger issues is why are my team members with a tiny budget that we operate on able to go online and put in simple search terms like buy cheetah cubs or sell elephant ivory and come up with hundreds of pages and groups openly selling in multiple languages, openly selling wildlife products. This doesn't take expensive AI to implement. Basic if code could remove these pages and groups, and that's a real problem. Moreover, the algorithms are amplifying the trade. And so firms like Facebook are not a passive actor in this. They're not just hosting hosting content that's moving around. Their algorithms are amplifying it, connecting buyers and sellers. And that's why we believe that this could rise to the level of RICO-style support for organized crime. Thank you.
That's a very important point. It's not just what they're not doing to police their platforms, it's their platforms are actually amplifying this. So thank you for that. Ms. Kessler, just in the final seconds I have, you've talked about conservation impacts. Are there also humane considerations tied to the online wildlife trafficking cartels?
Yes, absolutely. Wildlife trafficking, certainly that facilitated online or in physical marketplaces, is very inhumane and causes profound animal suffering. Turtles are smuggled, they're bound and taped and packed into suitcases. Songbirds are smuggled in hair curlers. And that's only after they've already been likely captured or restrained and put into those situations that they're transported then inhumanely. They are put in close confinement. That also, as we know now, is a breeding ground for zoonotic disease risks. So all along the chain from capture to through to transport, it's very inhumane.
Thank you very much. Mr. Benz, you're recognized for 5 minutes.
Thank you, Mr. Chair. So I'll start with Ms. Sensor, and just like to know, in your testimony has focused on perhaps deleting, removing content from social media and websites. Is that the most efficient way to address wildlife trafficking?
I think, as Mr. Gerton said, it's a combined arms approach. And you of course have to deal with the postings that are online. But you're also playing a game of whack-a-mole to a certain extent with that, as has been pointed out in others' testimony. people come back under false identities, you know, different groups. So getting left of the kill is really essential. You know, you want to prevent that animal from entering the supply chain in the first place. And I think it's also important to recognize that, you know, once that animal is being sold, or once that wildlife product is being sold, a lot of the damage has already been done. The animal's most likely dead in most cases, like ivory, you know, rhino horn, et cetera. But also, if it's carrying any diseases, that virus has been shedding all across that supply chain from the point of origin to the point of sale. So you really want to get to the left of the sale as much as possible. And that's why we have to invest in interventions as close to the source of these animals as we can.
Thank you for that. And a follow-up question, but this is to shift over to other countries that are complicit in this exercise. China, for example. Do you have any particular countries that should be doing more and are not?
I think every country can be doing more at this point, including the United States. You know, China has taken some very visible steps to dealing with the wildlife trade in their country, but the fact is that it still exists. And a lot of it has moved online and underground. And we haven't seen very many strong indications that they are cracking down to the extent that they need to be cracking down on that. Also, China has not made a tremendous amount of investment, at the sources. The United States, as Mr. Gerton said, has invested tremendously in enabling anti-poaching operations in Africa. China's made some investment, but it's significantly smaller than the United States has made.
And a question for Ms. Kessler. We've heard Facebook mentioned a lot this afternoon. Who else should we be talking about?
Hi, this is Casey. Okay, just making sure. Did that work?
Casey, you are unmuted. Sorry, Ranking Member Benz. We can. There you go.
That's okay. So let's go back. The question was for Ms. Kessler, if she's still available. And the question was quite simply, we talked about Facebook. Who else, if you were in charge, would you be suggesting be limited in some fashion to address this issue?
So, I mean, similar to that, there's not one country that we can point to. This is a global problem. I think it's very much similar for the internet platforms, that this is something that needs to be addressed across the industry for all current platforms, as well as those that may be up and coming, because as soon as something is policed more onto one platform, we've seen it in other contexts, there will be new ones that emerge, and that trafficking and the illegal activity that's happening on it will move to a new platform. So this, to me, is not about one individual platform, but really addressing this as an industry.
Thank you. And back to Ms. Simpson for just a moment. There's COVID-19 has impacted the illegal wildlife trade, I am sure, given the restrictions on people moving about the globe. What's happened as a result of COVID-19 in this space?
You know, what's most concerning to me about COVID-19 is that we've seen a global tourism shutdown. And in Africa specifically, you know, much of the conservation efforts, including, you know, the law enforcement efforts that accompany conservation, were dependent on tourism revenue. And we've had a year without that revenue. And it doesn't matter whether it's photo tourism revenue or hunting revenue, that tourism revenue is not there. And the agencies are increasingly strained from a budgetary standpoint. But even more importantly, the private concessionaires, the people who own the photo tourism concessions, the people who own the hunting concessions, have been incredibly stretched by this crisis. Now, many of them are holding on right now because they have gone into debt to continue to be able to pay their game scouts and to continue providing the jobs for the people that they did, even though the tourists haven't come. But that's not a sustainable strategy. And there's a big question right now about how long both national conservation agencies and private conservation interests, particularly those that were reliant on the tourism sector, can hold out. We've seen some declines in the poaching of some high-profile species in some places, but we've also seen increases in poaching for, you know, other wildlife, primarily so people can feed themselves.
Ms. Censor, we're out of time. I hate to hedge you off, but thank you so much. And Mr. Chair, I yield back.
I thank the ranking member, and we will go to Mr. Case for 5 minutes, and I believe you'll have the final word, Ed.
That's scary, Mr. Chair, but thank you. You all heard my questions to Mr. Gerton. Do any of you know whether the act of advertising is itself illegal? Okay. I take that as we don't know what the answer on that one is. I'm drawing an analogy. We've got illegal vacation rentals here in Hawaii, many, many illegal vacation rentals. And we have the same problem because they're being facilitated on online platforms. By state law, the act of advertising is illegal as for the people advertising. That is a step in the right direction. It still doesn't solve the Section 230 issue with the platforms who claim that they are not responsible for illegal activity on their platforms. And if they want to voluntarily try to crack down on it, that's up to them, but they don't have liability for it. That's the issue that we're talking about. So that's the reason for my question. But let me shift gears then and ask, you know, I guess the traditional model was smuggle illegally trafficked wildlife through the borders. That's enforcement. And then to some extent, it was marketed to the supply in more brick and mortar shops. So, you know, shops that you could go into, and maybe there would be a front room with legal stuff and a back room with illegal stuff. And we've tried to crack down on the back room with illegal stuff. And as we've done that, we have still seen the trade increase. Of course, part of that is advertising, but is the distribution chain changing? I mean, we still have the problem of enforcing our borders, which it seems to me are being overrun at this point, given all of our resources. But how in this online marketing world is the product getting to the recipient who is acquiring it illegally? Let's just talk about our country. I mean, is it still like, how does it actually get to the end user? Is it kind of like, well, you know, meet me in the parking lot at, you know, 3 a.m.?
I can answer that if you don't mind, sir. There's a variety of ways, but yes, the criminal supply chains have changed, have shifted as a result of many aspects of the criminal supply chain now take place online. The marketing, the communications, often the payment, and so all that is, and that can sort of reduce the number of actors in the supply chain. So the supplier will then have a job of getting the product, whether it's drugs or wildlife, directly to the buyer. There's more direct there's more direct contact between the two end stages of the supply chain. We see as more products moving through the mail. In the case of a live exotic pet or a live animal that's being trafficked, they are obviously have to be transported in different ways than just sticking them in an envelope or a box, although that does happen with some species. And yes, in some cases, again, it depends on the crime network. In some cases, there are person-to-person deliveries. But increasingly, we see illegal goods, whether it's drugs or wildlife goods, transmitted through mail services and transport services.
Okay. So I guess that gets us back a little bit to enforcement. Well, let me back up a second and ask you, you talked about RICO. And so I was sitting there mulling over RICO a little bit. I take it that all of your feeling is that this is far more of an organized crime enterprise than it used to be. So that in fact, crime syndicates of one kind or another are monopolizing a fair bit of the import distribution and delivery process? Or is there these independent actors?
Absolutely. That was also what Deputy Director Gerton said. We're seeing more evidence that these are large crime networks. And I think one of the things that I would like to see changed about the way the tech firms approach this is to go after is to have their internal intelligence operations go after or law enforcement or their internal enforcement actions go after networks as opposed to individual pieces of content. Some of our members are tracking very large wildlife networks or relatively small ones that are moving, that are responsible for a large percentage of the trade in a particular species, whether it's a chimpanzee or a cheetah or a type of wild parrot. Okay. So, you know, there's, I believe that if you look across the range of crimes occurring on social media, not just wildlife, but drugs, human trafficking, child sex abuse material, it starts to rise to the level of a company that is supporting a large and profiting off of a large amount of organized crime.
Understood. Okay, well, thank you. Since I have the last word, I just want to thank you for each and all of your passion and commitment. I think you have seen that many of us share it very much. And it's not a question of whether we have an issue. It's a question of exactly what do we do about it. So with that, Chair, back to you.
Well, I'm glad I gave you the last word because that was well said. And I want to thank all the witnesses. This was some excellent and very substantive testimony. Thank you to all the members for being engaged and asking thoughtful questions. The members of this committee may have some additional questions for the witnesses, and we will ask you to respond to those in writing under Committee Rule 3.0. Members of the committee must submit witness questions within 3 business days after this hearing, and the hearing record will be kept open for 10 business days to allow for responses. If there's no further business before the subcommittee, and I see none, then without objection, the subcommittee stands adjourned. Thanks, everyone.
Thank you.